occasionally thunderstorms, cumulonimbus clouds. Here's my cumulonimbus cloud, my thunderstorm, create tornadoes. Now, we don't know everything there is to know about tornado formation, but we do know quite a bit about the thunderstorms that generate them and the conditions in which they form. So let's talk about that. How do tornadoes develop? The key is vertical wind shear. We've already talked about and we've already explained what vertical shear is, and we already know that shear is almost always present in the atmosphere, but sometimes the shear is a little bit stronger and a little bit more favorable for tornado formation. In those cases where the shear is stronger, that's when you can develop ground level rotation. Let me explain. So let's draw a shear. The length of an arrow is going to represent the strength of the speed of the wind at that level. So if I draw wind shear here, the bottom arrow is much smaller than the top arrow. So the speed is much slower closer to the ground here than it is up above. Simple enough, right? That is wind shear. In the cases where it gets strong enough, the air starts to tumble over on itself. So for instance, if I were to put this marker in the way of the wind, the top would tumble over and the bottom would just kind of stay put. So it would tumble and it would start to turn like this. So everybody, hopefully you can see that the top would be pushed over by the wind, because the top wind, the wind up at this level, is stronger than the wind below it. So let's draw that on the paper. The air starts to tumble over on itself. Just like that, we have a horizontal rotation. So here, here, the air is starting to tumble over on itself, and you're starting to get this tumbling motion. Now that's in two dimensions. What does this look like in three dimensions? Because you also have to consider that while the wind is blowing this way, this object is going to also be moving in that direction. What ends up happening is you get slinkies. Yes, it's the return of the slinky. Slinkies develop on the surface of Earth. And just like because of the shear, the wind starts to take on a pattern like this. And it follows the motion of the wind, but it's tumbling over itself, and it's rotating horizontally. That becomes important because that slinky may encounter something that causes it to rush upwards. And what do you think happens if that slinky suddenly tilts upwards? You have rotation like this, suddenly like this. And that's the important key. I've switched slinkies to help you see it just a little bit better. So my green slinky here is now the air that's going to be spiraling along the ground due to vertical wind shear. So that wind shear, horizontal spiral, that horizontal spinning is going to be moving along the ground. Suddenly it encounters a thunderstorm. Here's my thunderstorm. It is a cumulonimbus cloud, right? Anatomically perfectly correct. So what happens? That updraft creating this storm suddenly pulls up that spiral, and now you've got a vertical spiral going on. What do you think you have? Well, here's the tricky part. We don't exactly know the final stages of tornado development. This process causes the whole storm to rotate, and in some instances, it really does cause tornado formation. But this is one of the remaining big questions in meteorology, is what is exactly going on that actually creates the tornado? Part of the problem is we can't see the air, so we don't know exactly where all the spin is coming from. But certainly, that spin that's coming along the ground that gets pulled up into the thunderstorm absolutely makes the thunderstorm rotate. What eventually causes the tornado? That's iffy. It might be the exact same process that just eventually works its way to the ground. We don't know that for sure. Let's do this process, but let's use the air and not the slinky. Let's see what happens. It's difficult for us to see the air. And it's also very difficult for the atmosphere to be vertical spin. So I've got a couple of tools that are going to help me create a tornado for you right here. The first,
to create the vertical spin, what I've done is I've created or overhead some clear sheets of plastic and put them in a spiral motion. Notice that they spiral inwards towards the center. At the center here is just a metal cup. Since we can't see the air, I also need something to help us see it. Because I promise you there is a tornado in the middle here. There is a tornado at the center here right now, but you can't see it because the air is invisible. So I need something to help us trace the air, basically. I've got dry ice to help us do that. Safety tip, never touch dry ice with your bare hands, right? Okay, now I'm going to put water in here. We now have our tracer. Tornadoes require vertical motion. If I were to take my fan and blow down, there's no tornado that's going to form. But if I, on the other hand, take my fan and simulate an updraft, so here's my storm. I'm going to simulate an updraft into the storm. And I've got tornado formation. Now, the process of creating vertical spin in the atmosphere is pretty complicated and is very difficult for a thunderstorm, not necessarily to do, but make it in a perfect spot that a tornado can form. This is part of the issue of forecasting tornadoes and part of the issue of studying tornadoes. It's very difficult to, one, be in the right location to study them, but it's also very difficult to understand, without being able to see the air, what exactly is going on in the atmosphere. This is why what's called tornado genesis, or the final process of creating a tornado, is one of the remaining mysterious questions in meteorology and atmospheric science. But no doubt it's a very, very neat phenomenon. So tornadoes need vertical motion, that is, upward vertical motion, in order to form. That causes any rotation near the surface to be stretched upwards, and that causes, just like an ice skater, to rotate faster and create a funnel. Now, we can't see normal tornadoes without things in the air. So for instance, unless there's dust or debris or condensation in order to see the tornado, we can't actually see the funnel. So in some instances, there may actually be a circulation on the ground, but we just can't see it because nothing's being kicked up by it. Once the tornado has dissipated because it no longer has vertical motion, it goes away, you no longer see the circulation. So just real briefly, what is actually happening in the tornado itself? Why is it creating that funnel and really spinning very quickly, both here in this experiment and in nature? The clear plastic sheets here are spiraling inwards, and are spiraling. Those are two very important keys. It's creating what's called vorticity, a technical name for it. It basically just spins the air. It's causing it to curve inward. And just like an ice skater, it's causing it to get tighter. And what's called conservation of angular momentum, it causes it to spin faster. So as I'm pulling the air upwards, it's forcing the air in tighter and tighter and tighter, and it's spinning tighter and tighter and tighter. Like an ice skater pulling their hands in, it causes the ice skater to spin faster. That's because it's conserving angular momentum, and the tornado spins very quickly then at the very center once it gets pulled upwards.